Now we are going to talk about how to estimate and simulate Markov chains. Recall that Markov himself in 1913 tried to study sequences of letters, namely sequences of vowels and consonants in Eugen Onegin poem by Alexander Pushkin. So vowels, let me remind you, it's A, O, U, and so on, and the consonants are B, D, C, and so on. That's the consonant letters. So as I said, Markov tried to study it in the Pushkin's poem, Eugen Onegin. It's quite popular in Russia, and there is even an opera, sometimes in Malmö opera, based on this poem. So let's have a look at this poem and see. So first we look at the very first verse in the poem. Мой дядя самых честных правил, когда не в шутку за не мог, он уважать себя заставил и лучше выдумать не мог. So we mark all the vowels in this text. First with the yellow pen. Oh, oops, I forgot. Actually, not everybody here understands Russian, so this is in Russian. So let's try the same poem in English. It is translated in English. So let's look at the same first verse of the poem in English and look at all the vowels in this poem. So Y, U, E, and so on. So with yellow pen, I mark all the vowels in this text. Well, maybe I missed some. I think I missed, what did I miss? I missed the last E in one. But otherwise, you can look at all the vowels in this text. And we can ask ourselves, for example, what is the frequency of vowels? So what part of the text are the vowels? Is it half of all the letters? Is it one third of the letters and so on? If you study the whole 200,000 letters of Eugen Onegin, you will find that the fraction of vowels is approximately 0.43. So this is what Markov has found. So the fraction of vowels is roughly 43% of all the letters, of all 20,000 letters in the text. But now we can ask you a question. Is vowel equally likely to be to follow after a vowel or after a consonant? So does it matter what is the preceding letter to a vowel? Will you get the same frequency or not? So if the answer to this question is positive, if the vowel is equally likely to be preceded by consonant or a vowel, one would expect how many pairs of vowels in the text. Well, you have to multiply 0.43 with itself. So that should be the probability of having two vowels in a row. So roughly 18% of all pairs of letters in this text should be pairs of vowels. So two consecutive vowels. So given that there are 200,000 letters, so you can start with any of this letter, you should expect something like of order 3,000 something pairs of vowels in the text. But if you look in the text and you will count the number of pairs, you'll find that there are approximately only 10,000 pairs of vowels. So about three times less than one would expect if the vowels would come as independent sequences, independent identically distributed sequence of Bernoulli random variables. So our assumption must have been incorrect, that the chance of seeing a vowel after a vowel should be different from the chance of seeing vowel after a constant. So you can model this as a Markov chain with two states. One state if the letter is a vowel, and another state if the letter is a consonant, and you have transition probability. So after vowel, you can have a consonant. After a consonant, you can have a vowel, or possibly you can go from also from consonant to consonant. You can possibly go from consonant to consonant or from vowel to vowel. And assume that the probability that after vowel you have vowel is alpha, and the probability that you have vowel after consonant is beta, then the probability of having consonant after consonant is 1 minus beta, probability of having consonant after vowel is 1 minus alpha. If the sequence of vowels were independent, then you would expect that the probabilities alpha and beta would be the same. So the probability that vowel is preceded by vowel and the probability that vowel is preceded by consonant would be the same. However, this doesn't hold for the text which Markov studied. So alpha is not equal to beta because it's a genuine Markov chain. And that's how he came up with the concept of Markov chain. So when the sequence is not independent, identically distributed, but actually depends on the previous step. Now assume that you have a Markov chain Xn, where n is 0, 1, 2, and so on some finite state space denoted by a calligraphic letter X. So the states are 0, 1, 2, up to R. So there are total R plus 1 different states. And you have some sequence of observation from this Markov chain. So you just observe this Markov chain for a certain number of steps, and let's denote observations by Y. So observations are X naught hat, X1 hat, X2 hat, and so on, up to Xm hat. The hat denotes that it's actually observation which you see. So each of them can be a number between 0 and R. And the question is, can you estimate the transition probabilities for this Markov chain after observing Y? The answer to this question is positive. Yes, you can estimate it. And we are going to speak now about how you do it. So first of all, for which state in the state space Markov chain, let Ni denote the number of i's, the number of times you can see I, this state in the sequence of Y. So that's numbers of those elements in Y which are equal to I. Also assume that the chain is irreducible, which means that you can reach from any state to any state. So you don't, as a result, you don't have absorbing states, and the states, all the states are recurrent. So you can reach any state from any state. You don't get stuck somewhere. You can actually show that if you have absorbing states, that it will be impossible to consistently estimate the transition probabilities. So let pi be the stationary distribution for this chain. In principle, the chain can be periodic, but the stationary distribution will still exist because it's irreducible and finite. And we also get that pi I must be strictly positive for each I, because the probability to come into each I is strictly positive, eventually from any state. So all pi I must be strictly positive for a finite state irreducible Markov chain. As a result, you get that Ni, the number of elements in the sequence divided by total number, m plus 1 or m, doesn't matter. If you divide it, it converges to pi I as m goes to infinity, if you have more and more observations. Convergence, almost surely, we didn't cover in this course. It's a stronger concept of convergence than we had before, but in particular, it implies convergence in probability. It's a stronger type of convergence of random variable. In particular, because pi is strictly positive, we know that the number of those elements in the sequence which are equal to I will converge to infinity. So you'll have more and more observations which are equal to I in this sequence. Now we introduce another quantity, Nij, for each pair of states, I and j, in the state space calligraphic x. And that's number of pairs, xi, xl, xl plus 1, which are equal to ij. So xl is equal to I. And the next one, xl plus 1 hat, is equal to j. So you count the number of pairs ij in the sequence y. Both have to be satisfied. And L runs, as I said, over all sequence from 0 to m minus 1. To m minus 1, because you have to xl plus 1, you have to define L xl plus 1, the last one. Then you can show that nij divided by ni converges almost surely to pij, to the true transitional probabilities, as m goes to infinity, for each I and j in the state space, calligraphic x. As a result, we can compute or estimate the transitional probabilities pij hat. We use the hat because it's an estimate, it's not the true transitional probability. We can estimate pi ij as this ratio, nij, the number of pairs ij, by the total number of elements which are equal to I in the sequence of observations. So this will be our method of estimation. Let us consider one example. Suppose that our Markov chain is defined on the state space, which has just two states, 0 and 1. And from 0, you can go to 1. From 0, you can go to 0. From 1, you can go to 0. And from 1, you can go to 1. Just a very simple Markov chain, two states. And you observe the sequence of zeros and ones. And it turns out that the sequence equals to 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, and 0. So you can see there are 15 elements in this sequence, or there is also two ones. So totally there are 15 elements in this sequence. And our problem is to estimate the transitional probabilities for this Markov chain, which is drawn on the picture, based on these observations. First of all, we count how many zeros we have in this sequence. There are 15 observations, as I said, in total. And six of them are zeros, and the remaining nine of them are ones, 15 in total. So N0 is equal to six, and N1 is equal to nine in this case. Now let's count how many times we go from zero to one. So we'll count all the pairs 0, 1. 1, first, second, third, and fourth. So total, there are four pairs 0, 1 in this sequence. So we can write n 0, 1 is equal to 4. But what is n 1, 0? The number of sequences 1, 0. So we count all the sequences of 1, 0. The first one, the second one, and here is the third one. So n 1, 0 is equal to 3. So the three sequences 1, 0. Now we can estimate P0, 1 and P1, 0. In particular, P0, 1, the estimate of probability go from 0 to 1 will be 4 N0, 1 divided by 6, which is N0, which is approximately 0.67. And the estimate of probability 1, 0 will be equal N1, 0 divided by N1. So it's 3/9, which is approximately 0.33. It's 1/3. And we can put these numbers on the picture. So we estimate this probability of going from 0 to 1 is 0.67. The probability of going backwards is 0.33. And you can also work out what's the probability of going back from 1 to 1 and from 0 to 0 is 1 minus those probabilities. And the reason for that is that your estimate of probability of going from 0 to 0 is just 1 minus the estimate of probability going from 0 to 1. And similarly, the probability of going from 1 to 1, the estimate is 1 minus the estimate of going from 1 to 0, because the probabilities have to sum up to 1 for leaving from each state. Now, assume that you have a very large text like Eugene Onegin, where you have lots of letters. You can have the state space, which is larger than just vowels and consonants, not just two states, but you can have much richer state space. For example, all the Latin letters in this text from A, B, C up to Z. And if you have it in Swedish, you have three more letters. And if you have such a big state space, you can try to find all the transitional probabilities P, I, J, where each I and J is a letter in the Latin alphabet. It would require quite a lot of work, I must say. So for this, we would need some sort of tool. And this tool, yes, is a computer. We can do it on a computer, on a write a computer program, which will analyze for us and find all the estimates of those transition probabilities. So it will be 26 times 26 matrix. Markov, of course, couldn't do this in his time because there were no computers at the time. So he didn't have the opportunity to do that. He had to restrict himself only with vowels and consonants, but we can do it now. Now, because we have a more powerful computers these days, we can have even more complicated state spaces and compute much larger matrices with the transition probabilities. In particular, we can consider not as a state space, not the letters, but sequences of letters, A, 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 B, A, C, and so on. So you have 26 squared different states, all pairs of letters. Not just letters, but pairs of letters. So X, your state space is much larger now. And you can analyze, this is a Markov chain in some text. For example, is AA followed by BB and so on. And we can estimate all the transition probabilities for this Markov chain, whose state space is, as I said, much larger. Obviously, some of these transition probabilities will be zero. For example, two letters B will never be followed by two letters B and B again, because there are no word which has four B's in the rows. We can even push this further. We can consider triples of letters like A, 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 B, and so on. So there will be huge probability space, and we can compute, estimate various probability, transitional probabilities, for example, as probability, what is the probability that three letters E, X, and A are followed by three letters M, and E, and N. We know that this probability is positive for a very large text. So I wrote a program in C++, which can extend it to much larger sequence of letters. So I think I went all the way up to the sequences of letters of length 7. And obviously your matrices will be really huge, but you need a lot of memory in computer. I don't remember exact number. Maybe it was slightly lower than 7, but still it was a huge database for all pairs of letters. And again, obviously lots of these transition probabilities will be zero. But the question is, once you estimated all these transition probabilities, what can you do with those? How can you use these PIJs, the estimated transition probabilities? So what can you do with these PIJs? With the help of these estimated transition probabilities, you can generate a Markov chain, simulate a Markov chain, which has these transitional probabilities as given. So if you are given a probability transition matrix P, on the state space from 0 to r, so it has r plus 1 elements, you have r plus 1 times r plus 1 square matrix with the transitional probabilities from p 0 0 up to p r r, so r plus 1 square total different transitional probabilities, you might generate a Markov chain with given transitional probabilities. How do you do that? Well, the algorithm is quite simple. Assume that at time n, you're in the position I, and you want to generate the next step of the Markov chain. What you do, you let xn plus 1, the next element, to be chosen according to the probability distribution given by the ith row of the matrix P. So it basically means you choose xn plus 1 equal to j with probability pij, and this is true for each J in the state space. So choose the next step, xn plus 1. And that's how we choose the next step of a Markov chain. After which, this will be your next stage. And the only thing you have to do is then to repeat this procedure. So now you have to repeat this algorithm and choose xn plus 2 according to this rule and so on. With this method, you will be able easily generate as many steps of the Markov chain as you want. So you can generate Markov chain of length 1,000 or 1,000,000 or 10,000,000, depending on how many you need, as long as you have it on your computer. For example, you can apply this method to some large text, some literature text, like Eugene Onegin, for example. And you take this large text and you need a large text to get, because you have to estimate lots of transitional probabilities. So the larger the text is, the better your estimates will be. So on the first step, you estimate the transition probabilities, all the possible transition probabilities from sequences of letters. Again, many of them will be zero, but that's fine. But some of them will be positive. Secondly, you simulate Markov chain in the, by the algorithm which I described above, according to the estimated transition probabilities which you have from step one. So using this p-hat ij, you generate a Markov chain. And if your state space is sufficiently rich, for example, you include all the sequences of four letters, for example, or five letters in a row, and you find all the transition probabilities, so you use large sequences of letters, say of large length, for example, seven, as I said, but sometimes even lower number is good. So I'll show you example when this number is four, when you estimate all the probabilities from four letters to four letters, all the transition probabilities are coming from four letters to some other four letters, then this randomly generated text will look like actually original text produced by the author of the book. So it will generate pseudo text by which will look like a text by the same author. And I'll show you two examples. So the first example is when we estimated the transition probabilities for sequences of four letters from The Hobbit, from Tolkien's Hobbit text. And this is the generated text according to the Markov chain with the transition probabilities estimated from the real Tolkien's literature. So this text is completely computer generated as a Markov chain. Another example in Swedish is from the Swedish fairy tale Karlsson på taket, so Karlsson on the roof. It's also using the sequences of four letters, and this is also randomly generated text based on the transition probabilities from this fairy tale.